Okay, we'll get started. I think there's still maybe a couple of folks coming in. Let me introduce myself. My name is John Davis. I'm WB4QDX. I've been involved in D-Star for quite a few years now. Not one of the very early adopters of D-Star, but I've been in it about 4 years. I've been teaching different D-Star classes and conducting seminars around the country for the last 2 or 3 years. So I think you'll get the benefit of a lot of the experiences that I've had around, as well as a lot of the input I've had from the different classes. I am also very much involved in my local club and also in ARIES. And D-Star, you'll find, has some great uses in emergency communications. I'm an emergency coordinator in my county in Georgia in the suburban Atlanta area. I'm also a DEC in the Georgia section. And have had the opportunity to use D-Star in a lot of emergency communications applications. Also a part of the Georgia D-Star group, which is kind of an informal group. We have put up several repeaters, probably about a dozen repeaters around the Georgia area. Have quite a bit of coverage, especially in the Atlanta area. And you're going to learn today how to get the most out of your D-Star radio, or if you have not purchased one yet and are just interested in learning about it, we hope you'll get the information you need today. Just as a point to start, I see a lot of radios out on the table, so I'm not going to ask how many are already into D-Star, but let me ask how many do not yet have a radio or any of the D-Star devices and are interested in getting into it, if you would raise your hand. So we've got a few people that are just getting into it. Wow, I think you've come to the right place to buy a radio if you really want to do that. All right, we're going to do this in several modules today, and you have a copy of all of the slides that will be presented in your red folders, and we'll try to go through that. If you have any questions, another person will be joining us in here, Chris, W4FH, will be joining me in just a few minutes, and he will have a wireless mic that he can bring around for your questions so that we make sure we capture them on the video as well. We're going to start this morning with kind of an introduction to D-Star. If you've been in it for a while, some of this may be old news to you, but for those who are brand new, we'll try to cover some of the very basics of D-Star. First off, I wanted to dispel one of the myths that seems to always come up. You may have heard, or you may be of a mindset right now, that you think D-Star is a proprietary protocol or mode. It is not. D-Star is an open standard that was developed for amateur radio by the Japan Amateur Radio League. It's an open standard that is available for any of the manufacturers. The protocol is published, for example. It does use one proprietary chip, the vocoder, and that's the AMBE chip, and it's manufactured by a company called DVSI. They are probably the worldwide leader in voice coding technologies, and just about any digital radio uses one of their family of chips. That's a very small part of a D-Star radio, though, but it is a very important part. And that is what converts your voice from analog to digital, and then the digital data stream that's transmitted over the air back to analog. Now, ICOM has the notoriety of being the first of the major manufacturers of amateur radio equipment to produce D-Star radios under the open D-Star standard. They may not be the only one ever. In fact, I think there may be some announcements here at Dayton with some other vendors, not among the major ones, but some other parties that may be developing some other D-Star equipment as well. So check around, and in your packet, in the front flap, you'll see several things. One is a schedule of events, most of them happening today. The D-Star Forum at 12:45 in Forum Room 1. We'll try to get through in here in time so you can get over for that. Tonight, we would like to invite you back right here in this room starting 6:30 for D-Star across America, and we'll probably have between 150 and 200 D-Star enthusiasts, if we've had in past years, and we'll have a series of speakers that you'll probably find of interest with some light refreshments in the back even. So we'd like to invite you back here this evening. At the bottom of that list, you'll also see some of the booths at Hamvention that may be related to D-Star and some of the related digital activities. How does D-Star work? Well, first off, if you listen to a D-Star signal on your regular FM radio, it's going to sound like a hiss or a buzz. That's the digital signal over the air. It is actually digital modulation. To be specific, it is called GMSK modulation. It is transmitted at 48 bits per second data rate over the air. Now, that 4,800 bits are divided up into first, the first half, 2,400 bits for voice. Another 1,200 bits is forward error correction. What is forward error correction? That helps to reconstruct the signal if bits are dropped, as in interference, low signal level. So 3/4 of the 4,800 bits per second are dedicated to voice. Now that leaves another 1,200, and that 1,200 allows you to transmit data along with your voice. Now we'll talk about different things that can be done with that data, but you're basically getting kind of packet speed data along with that. Now there's another form of high speed data that we'll talk about in a little bit that is transmitted on the 1.2 gigahertz or 23 centimeter band. Now, how does D-Star compare to some of the other digital technologies that are out there? First, this is equivalent, roughly, to narrowband transmission. A D-Star signal only occupies about half the bandwidth that your traditional FM or analog signal occupies in the band, or only about 6.25 kilohertz. If you look at traditional FM, you're talking about 12 or 13 kilohertz occupied bandwidth. Yes, it's 5 kilohertz deviation in FM, but that takes up a total of about 12.5-13 kilohertz. Now, if you compare that to some of the other digital technologies that you might be familiar with, P25 or APCO 25, Project 25, as it's known by several names, is used in commercial public safety transmissions. A lot of the new digital systems that the fire, police, and different municipalities are using is based on an interoperability standard called P25. That is totally different. It has been evolving in its standards as well, but the current generation of that, it is twice as wide as D-Star, but you actually have two different signals transmitted as time division, as two time slots on that carrier. So you'll hear sometimes it referred to as narrowband equivalent or 6.25 kilohertz equivalent, but it is actually transmitting a total of 12.5 kilohertz wide. Same thing for another technology called Moto Turbo. Both of these are commercial land mobile radio standards that are used in commercial applications or public safety, but have been adopted that can be used in the amateur band. One of the main differences that I like to say as a real difference between Moto Turbo, P25, and D-Star is, D-Star was developed for amateur radio, so it has a lot of the features built in that hams will use. On the other side, the two commercial standards are just that and are being adopted and may not have some of the features that we're looking for, but all are digital technologies. One of the things that is always said about D-Star, I don't say always, but in many cases, is that it depends on the internet. Well, if you are linking from one repeater to another, yes, that goes and travels over the internet. However, you can operate simplex, or you can operate on your local repeater and have most of, actually, the same features. So this question comes up a lot of times for emergency communications, where you're saying, well, you can't always depend on the internet. If you lose the internet, what you lose is your ability to link to another repeater or reflector, which we'll talk about. But you still can talk within your local area, have the voice and data features of D-Star. Repeaters go down, don't they? So if you lose your repeater, you still can operate simplex, and within a local area or within the range of your radio, you can still transmit digital voice and data within that area. So it still retains a lot of the useful features. What can D-Star do? First off, you are transmitting voice and data together. Remember the 1200 baud data plus your speech. And those are available on radios currently in the 2 meter, 440, and 1.2 gigahertz bands. Now, when I say you're transmitting data, we think a lot of times of packet. Now, what does it take to put a packet station on the air? You have a radio, you either have a TNC or some type of sound card interface, and your computer. D-Star takes away one step, one piece of hardware in that you can transmit data with no TNC. In fact, all you need at a minimum is a handheld, the interconnecting cable, and your computer. And you can be on the air transmitting data in relatively a short amount of time. The data side of this, because you can also transmit position information, GPS position information, a lot of people equate this to APRS. Well, the D-Star community calls it DPRS, or substituting A with a D for digital. And so you can transmit that position information along with your voice, and you don't have to have the extra equipment. To do APRS and voice, what kind of equipment would you have to have? You'd basically have to have two radios, right? And a TNC, one for voice radio and one for data, and a TNC or a tiny track or something like that would have a built-in transceiver, but you're transmitting two different signals. You have the advantage on D-Star of only needing one radio. You can do very flexible repeater linking. I mean, I go back, unfortunately, to the early days of repeaters, let's say back in the, I'll say the 70s, anyway, when repeaters started coming on the scene in a little more popularity. And we didn't even link repeaters. But now we have the ability by various means to link repeaters together. But you usually have to have a link between them, either by radio or some other method that establishes that link, but I can link here or I can link to this group of repeaters, but I can't selectively connect to one repeater only. D-Star gives you that ability to do that very flexible linking to one repeater or one area. We'll talk about that. Reflectors. Reflectors, the best way to describe them, they're a big conference bridge. There's no radio attached to them, but you link repeaters or other radio devices to reflectors. And what goes into one reflector comes out on all of the ones that are connected to it. So it's a quick way to connect to a reflector that has West Coast repeaters connected or those in Italy, wherever it may be, or in the Southeast. And then there are other devices that have been developed by other third-party groups. We'll talk in a little bit more detail about the DV dongle, the DV access point, and DV node adapters. And they're another way to access D-Star, either with or without a radio. In some ways, it's kind of similar to Echolink. So we'll spend a little bit more time and I'll show you some of those devices. D-Star continues to grow. Here's kind of a graph through the end of last year. And you see in the number of gateways, repeaters, and users, that has continued to grow. And I pulled these stats over last weekend, and currently there are about 22,000, almost 23,000 registered D-Star users around the world. And that has grown at a rate of anywhere between 30 and 50% per year. It's hard to keep up those numbers as you start getting into large numbers in percentage-wise basis, but it does continue to grow. So has the number of repeaters and gateways, and a gateway may have one to up to four repeaters attached to it. So that number continues to grow. Almost 2,000 repeaters are now on the air around the world, and over half of those are in the U.S. Very simply, a D-Star linked QSO, you go in from your local radio into your local repeater. That repeater goes through a gateway and connects to the internet, kind of a voice over IP type protocol. And then it comes out the other end into another repeater. That can be across town, or it can be around the world. I've met quite a few folks from Australia that I talk to regularly now from down under. They'll either be on a common repeater that I'm on, or I'll connect to something where they are. Reflectors and nets. As I said, reflectors are a giant conference bridge. They are a server-type computer that is located in a location that is generally a high bandwidth location, like a commercial data center or a business that has at least a 10 megabit dedicated connection it can allocate to this. Currently, there are 53 reflectors around the world. And we have a list of those that you can look at dstarinfo.com under reflectors. Now, each one of these reflectors has five separate modules. And four of those are available just like there are four separate reflectors. Each one is independent, A through D. E is for echo testing. If you connect your local repeater, if you connect your DV dongle or DV access point to the E module of a reflector, and you transmit, and then it will play back your audio so you can see the and hear the quality of the audio you transmitted. The addition of the D and E modules on reflectors is something that's just happened in the last two or three months, an enhancement to the software. Now, as far as nets go, there are regional, national, and international nets that have cropped up on dedicated to D-Star. I'll tell you about one of those we have developed, which started as a local Atlanta area net, but has grown into a Southeast D-Star weather net. And on Sunday nights at 9 p.m. Eastern, 8 p.m. Central Time, we have repeaters from Texas through the Carolinas along the Southeast connected together for a net to practice operating on a regional linked repeater network. And we have about 35 or 40 repeaters typically connected, and we have about 70 to 80 check-ins that we go through in this one-hour net to practice, because the Southeast has some unique weather conditions, such as thunderstorms, tornadoes, which is not strictly limited to the Southeast, but we have our share, as well as tropical weather that can come in from the Gulf or from the Atlantic. So practicing and using D-Star on a regional net is great. If you, again, want to go to the dstarinfo.com website, you will see a list of nets. There's a tab that you can find the list there. A lot of these nets are for a regional area, or they may be a certain interest group, but they are available and generally open to connect to. And again, we talked about linking repeaters. If you link a repeater to a reflector, then everyone who is also linked to that reflector becomes one giant network. If you connect to reflector 30C or 30 Charlie, as we call it, You will be coming out on about 30 repeaters around not only the southeast, but a large area as well. Now, if you want to see who is connected to a reflector or to a repeater, this URL is handy to be able to use, where I have ref number. If you will substitute the reflector number, and that will be in the format of REF and three numbers, like REF001 or REF053. dstargateway.org/status.html, and it will bring up a dashboard page, and it will show you, if it's a reflector, it'll show you what all is connected in the way of repeaters, and it will show you a last heard list. Same thing for repeaters. If you want to look at what a local repeater is connected to and the last heard list on it, instead of ref number, you would substitute the call sign of that repeater. w8rtl.dstargateway.org. And by the way, if you did not know, the repeater 38C is located in, where is it actually located, Joe? Is it in Dayton? Or
Cleveland.
It's in Cleveland, but it is an Ohio-based reflector, and it is being used as kind of the host for the Hamvention. So a lot of repeaters around the world, I haven't looked at the list, but I imagine there are a lot of repeaters connected to listen to activity around Hamvention here. And if you want a listing of both reflectors, nets, again, dstarinfo.com is a site that will help you there. All right, that's our first module. Now we're getting through. Give me just a second to get to the next one. Any questions while we're starting there?
My name's Mike Moore, KC2NM, and I'm fairly new to this. My question is regarding reflectors. Is there a ranking of the popularity of reflectors? I'm thinking in terms of, you know, how to program the radio. I would like to put, like, say, the Atlanta reflector at the top and the London reflector. Is there any way to sort that list by...
There is not, but I can tell you which are the, I'll say, the most popular reflectors at this point. One is, probably the most popular, is reflector 1C, 1 Charlie. I call that almost the mega reflector. If you want to talk to anyone around the world any time of the day or night, that's a good one. I believe our Georgia-based reflector 30 and 30C is the popular module on that, is about the second busiest. Reflector 12 and reflector 14 are popular out for West Coast stations. You'll see some of them that have a certain, I call, personality or flavor. And if you go to the dstarinfo.com reflectors, you'll see a brief description on those we've been able to find, that this may be an Italian language reflector or West Coast or Spanish speaking, whatever it may be. Did you have something else?
Thank you, Joe. My name is Will, K-D-A-G-I-K, and I do have a Colombia call sign. And my question for you, John, is I noticed that when the website, dstarinfo.com, before get the last upgrade or update, or when they change, you know, used to be a tab to change to many different languages. And I can't find
it. On the dstarinfo.com website.
Before, you know, got the green look, you know, the previous version, I would say, I can find that. What I ask you is because in Colombia, they are in the process of installing a digital repeater that I can donate it, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I told them before that they could, you know, go to the website and put everything in Spanish, because I did it many times, you know, when it was like kind of orange, and I mean, before the new look. And I can find that tab.
I don't think it's built into the website anymore, but I think... Google has some type of translation utility that may be of help. I'll talk to our webmaster on that, but as far as I know, that capability is not there. Sorry.
My name is Robert, call NQ to you. A friend of mine is an engineer, and ICOM gave him D-Star equipment. We're down in South Florida, and he's basically got it set up, and right now he has it in his home. Eventually he's going to get it up on the tower. My question is, as a user in an area that's really not, doesn't have a lot of D-Star repeaters, am I better off, he's got his gateway set up, am I better off going into a reflector first so I can meet people, or go connect to his D-Star repeater and see what's happening through the repeater side?
I'll briefly answer that question, but I think at the very end of today, our last module, I'll address that a little bit more. One of the things that if you put up a repeater locally, a lot of people will, by default, link that local repeater to a busy reflector so that they hear activity locally, get people interested. You can always unlink and link at your discretion, and I'll show you how to do that. But if you can't hit the local repeater, we'll be talking about, I think in this next module, with the DV dongle and DV access point or node adapters, how you can still be active in D-Star if you're not currently within the range of a local repeater. Yeah, I think I've heard that repeater is going to be coming on and going to its permanent site soon. Yes. Okay. Let's move on to the next one. And this will probably take us up to our first break. What is available for D-Star radios right now? Right now through ICOM, you will see a full range of equipment. This is not a commercial for ICOM, but they are right now the primary manufacturer of equipment. And they produce both a series of mobiles and handhelds. There is a vendor who is looking to introduce a independently manufactured D-Star compatible radio here. I think they are called Northwest Digital, but look them up, and they may be listed in your groups on the handout, and they may be, if you can't find them while you're there. And there will always be other equipment being offered. One of the first pieces of equipment that was offered is a DV dongle. It's a non-radio device. Again, I'll equate it to its operation similar to Echolink, because it connects directly to a computer, usually say a laptop or a desktop. This is the device. It connects via USB. We'll go into this in a little more detail. But then using your computer sound card with a headset is recommended. You can get on D-Star and access any repeater or any reflector, make it very easy to do. Now, another device was introduced shortly after that called the DV access point. Looks very similar, except it's red, and you see something new on this, different, an antenna. It actually is a, I'll call it like a mini hotspot, because it has a 10 milliwatt, 2 meter transceiver built into it. So if I am out of range of a repeater, I'm traveling, whatever, I hook this via USB to my computer, and then I can walk around with my handheld and access and do all the linking, unlinking, whatever commands I want through my local radio. We'll go into a little bit more detail on that. Both of those are available. And then node adapters, and I meant to bring mine with me, several manufacturers are developing little boards, and they allow you to connect to a more traditional FM radio and convert it into a hotspot. For example, I'll just use an example because I do this at home. I have a Yaesu FT8800. I plug it in the packet port, use the 9600 baud input because it's a flatter response for the data, and then it creates a hotspot of up to the power of that radio that then connects. It's not converting the radio to a D-Star radio, but it creates a hotspot that I can then access with my either handheld or right around the area. So those are both available. All three are actually available as D-Star accessories. Because ICOM was the first to offer a complete line of mobiles and handhelds, I will give you more information on those because that's likely the radio that either you have, want to add another radio. These are like potato chips. You can't have just one. And you may be interested in buying while you're here at Hamvention. They have all of them except two are dual band 2 meter 440. The exceptions are the brand new radio, the ID31A, is a 440 only, 70 centimeter only radio. There are a lot of very neat features in that, including a built-in database of all the repeaters that you can update, and has GPS built into it, so you can say, here I am, wherever I am on the face of the earth, where is the closest D-Star repeater? I'm programmed, ready to go, ready to talk. But it is 70 centimeter only. The other one that is a single band unit is the ID1. It is a 1.2 gigahertz or 23 centimeter radio. Now, you can do voice and the 1200 baud data on that radio, but you can also do high speed data. And it is packetized Ethernet, acts like an Ethernet bridge, I guess is the best way to describe it, and has an Ethernet port, and you can transmit data at up to 128 kilobits. But again, it's 1.2 gigahertz, so propagation comes into play on that in consideration. Now, here's a feature that I really like about all of the ICOM radios. And this is probably going to be true for most any D-Star radio. They have a built-in serial port right in every one. Now, it's a simple serial port, 3-pin, and so it plugs right into the radio, transmit data, receive data, and ground. But that allows me to send data and connect a laptop with one cable to my radio, and I can do data transmission. Very simple to do, doesn't require a TNC or any external level adapters or anything. It uses the RS-232 voltage levels. My first cable I made myself. Didn't look too good, but it worked, so I've since purchased a few cables commercially made, but very easy way to get into data. Another feature of some of the radios, they either have GPS built in, as in the 2820 mobile, dual band, dual receive mobile, comes with built-in GPS, and it has an external GPS antenna for a mobile application. The ID31 handheld has built-in GPS, or for most of the handhelds, you can have a GPS microphone, where the GPS radio is actually built into the microphone, and it will send your position information over that data channel. To take a look at some of the ICOM mobiles, very first radios that were offered were the 2200 and the 800. These were the initial offerings that had, they were FM radios, but they had the ability to add a board where that you could add D-Star capabilities. For those of you that have a 2200 that wanted to convert it to D-Star by adding the radio, it only gives you limited functionality that I think you only have four memories that you can use, which limits you quite a bit. The 800 is a good radio. It was replaced with the 880, which enhanced some features as well. The 2820 is the dual band, dual receive, top of the line mobile. It's also the most expensive of them. I hate to say I have two of them, but they're very handy. If you want the dual receive functionality, you can receive one FM and one D-Star frequency simultaneously. You cannot receive two D-Star channels at the same time. But that works for me, my local FM club repeater I keep on one side, and my D-Star repeater on the other side. In the handheld line, The 91 AD was the very first one that was offered. That was my first radio as well. It's a dual band, dual receive, so you can monitor two frequencies again, one FM, one D star at the same time. About 18 months later, I believe it was, the 92 AD was released. It replaced the 91 AD, but it offered some new features. It's slightly larger, which gave it a little more heat sink area of the case inside, which helped some with the 91 would tend to get warm to hold in your hand if you were in 5 watts and transmitting a lot. The 92 being a little larger gave it more heat sink, but it also is a waterproof capability. I've never dropped one of these waterproof radios in the lake or the bathtub or any other body of water to see how that works, but I'm not willing to try that out. On the 92 AD, they did introduce a very unique multi-pin connector. Part of it was to retain the waterproof nature of it when you plug it in, but so far I don't believe, I remember I had a Yaesu VX7, and when they came out with that 4-pin plug, you know, initially you couldn't get that, and finally someone started making those. I don't know of any manufacturers that have made this one. It's kind of a unique, very unique plug, which means you need a different data cable or programming cable, which has that very unique connector on it. But again, it's waterproof. The IC80 handheld was introduced as a lower cost handheld. It was introduced about 2 years ago, I believe. And it is a dual band, but it is single receive. And its mobile counterpart is the 880. And then we talked about the ID31A, which is the latest handheld. Some really neat features in that it, but it is 70 centimeter only. It is waterproof also. It has an SD card that will hold a lot of memories. You can update the memories on that, and you can do downloads, which I'll show you how to do a little bit later from the dstarinfo.com database. It's a lot more user-friendly in the user interface. It's easy to get on the air, find the closest repeater, and sets that channel for you. Now, on 1.2 gigahertz, I'd never done any 1.2 gigahertz radio until I got my ID1, but I find it is especially handy for not only doing the voice and low-speed data, but the high-speed data mode. It's very difficult to transmit anything above about 9600 baud using packet modes, and that gets pretty picky in a lot of radios. But you can send up to 128 kilobit, and it is formatted as Ethernet. So if you have two ID1s, they can be an Ethernet bridge between two points, or a lot of the repeaters have a high-speed data module, which will allow you to have not the fastest in the world, but much faster than a lot of different modes, access to the internet. Any questions about these radios? Yes, sir.
My question is the ID1 data rate fast enough to support the internet connection that would be used to link the voice portion of a repeater to the internet?
Meaning using it to connect to the internet and
yes.
As a wireless link?
Yes.
Not generally.
Okay.
We've had that question before. It does have a lot of very handy uses. For example, my local areas group, we have an ID1 in our communications trailer, and it will provide not the fastest in the world, but again, some internet connectivity for our computers inside. Also, if we're doing transmission using other programs like DRATs, et cetera, it's handy for transferring data. Now, we actually had an application where we put an ID1 in an airplane, and we had a requirement to take photographs, as in simulating over a disaster area, and they wanted to get those photographs back to the Georgia Emergency Management Headquarters on a timely basis. What they had used that for in the past was they would use sat phones. They will only transmit at 9,600 baud. They could not send the photos while the plane was flying. They had to land and then send the photos. So when we found that we could do this, we actually made a little 1.2 antenna on an NMO mount. It was only about that long, and we replaced a inspection port on the bottom of the Cessna 172 with this NMO base, and we would actually take pictures from the air and send them over the 1.2 to the internet through a repeater. And we actually posted the pictures on a Google Picasa website. Now, we could encode the GPS data for the position with them. And so they had in the metadata of the photo, they actually had the picture and the general location where it was, where the aircraft was at that time. And that really sold our state emergency management folks on some of the capabilities of D-STAR. The DV dongle, we touched on this a few minutes ago, connects to your laptop or computer via a USB cable, so it gets its power there. It has some software that you load on your computer, and then using the sound card, and I do recommend you getting some type of a headset to use. Don't use the computer microphone and speaker. It will sound horrible. But you can then connect to a repeater or a reflector without a radio, and you enter your call sign in the software that's available, and you're on D-STAR. This sells for right at $200, so it is the least expensive way to get into D-STAR. It has software that will run on a Mac, on Linux, or a Windows machine. And so it's available for just about any computer. And it's a great way to get into D-STAR. When I first got in, my first two purchases were a dongle and a 91AD. And I used this when I traveled from the hotel room. All I needed was internet access to be able to use it. About a year later, the DV access point came out. And again, it connects to your computer via the USB port. And it has a built-in 10 milliwatt 2-meter transceiver. Now, that's going to get you about 100 meters. It's an SMA connector. Some have connected to a external or a higher gain antenna to increase the range. Question always comes up, can I hook an amplifier to this? Don't do it. Number one, this is not the cleanest signal in the world, so you would not want to transmit it at 50 watts, 100 watts. Plus, it is made for just operating at 10 milliwatts. But it's great for if I wanted to create a hotspot and give everyone access in the room, I could do that. That works out very well. And the Windows software module comes for it. Again, it's available and will operate on a Mac, Linux, or a Windows box. $249, I think, is the price on it. So it's about $50 more than the DV dongle.
What's the free airspace transmission at that wide?
It's about 100, depending, you know, if you're going through walls and things, but generally about 100 meters, 100 yards, 300 feet, somewhere in that area. Works very well, and you can adjust the power on it as well, so you can limit it from that 10 milliwatts down. DV node adapters, now these are available from several different sources around the world. It's a small circuit board, as you can see in the upper right. One of the key features of it is the AMBE chip is included to be the vocoder. And the idea behind it is that you can connect it between your computer and generally an FM radio. Recommended that that FM radio have a 9600 baud packet port. Why 9600 baud? This being a digital signal, you want as flat a response as you can have. And generally, the 9600 baud ports will go closer to the modulator and closer to the discriminator to give you a much flatter response than the 1200 baud port. And then it acts just like the DV access point, except quite a bit more power, whatever the power of your radio. There are a lot of folks around the country, around the world, that instead of a repeater, invested in this for a hotspot. Now, it is not a repeater. So if you're over in this area and your friend is over in this area, both within range of the hotspot, you're not talking to each other because you're on a simplex channel. You're not repeating it through the node adapter. However, you are going to the D-Star data stream and into the internet. So you both can talk to a reflector or a repeater. You had a question?
Yes. I'm not familiar with the node adapters up till now. What price range do they run?
I think I paid $120 for mine, and that's the board and the cables, and there's some software. It's available from several different sources. I think we're going to have a gentleman, I think it's Moencom, E-O-M-O-E-N-C-O-M-M, that may have some available in our booth in Audio Alley. That's the one I have here, and it uses some software from the Dutch Star folks, I think, that was developed. There are several different ones available, so I'm not going to recommend one or one over another one.
So a node adapter is cheaper than an access point, and if you have a radio like I have, a Kenwood THF6A that does have 9600, I can use that instead.
Instead of a DV access point.
And then I'll have a little bit more range as well.
That's correct. That's exactly right.
So that's the way to go.
That's the main advantage to that. If you're not within range of a D-Star repeater locally and you're looking for coverage, that's a good way to do it.
Does the software come with the node adapter?
Generally, yes. You may have to go out to another site and download it. I think the software by itself has to be licensed, but for example, with the board I purchased, the license comes with it. I just had to go download the software and set it up. Any questions on these?
My question regarding the access point and the node adapter, the radio that you use to communicate this or with these devices, in both cases, is a D-Star radio.
No. With a node adapter you're speaking
of. Okay.
The node adapter can, the idea behind it, it takes an analog radio, an FM radio, and allows you to use it to communicate with a D-Star radio like your handheld.
Yes. But in the case of the handheld that's shown in this drawing that is talking to the handheld on the left,
yes,
is not an FM analog,
correct,
radio. It is a D-Star radio.
Correct. This is a D-Star radio. The analog radio is being converted by the node adapter to transmit in the D-Star format. So it is giving this analog radio digital modulation in the D-Star format. Does that make sense?
And the same with the DV access point.
The DV access point communicates only with a D-Star radio.
Okay. Where I'm going with this is our repeater trustee would like to gen something up to listen to the repeater, to monitor the repeater, and neither of these would be appropriate for talking to the repeater.
No, because you could link to the repeater.
Yes, you could.
As in link here.
Yes.
But you are not monitoring,
right,
the repeater.
You're not monitoring the output of the repeater.
Correct.
Thank you.
So what you're saying is, are you transmitting from the portable in digital format?
Yes.
Into the 8800?
Yes.
And the node adapters interpreting that and getting it out.
Yeah, it's able, the node adapter is able to take the off-air received signal, which is a digital signal, and convert it, decode it in a sense, and be able to send it to the internet.
And you're showing an 8800 there, which has crossband technology. So you could feasibly talk into it on 77 meters and come out on 2 meters.
No, we're not using the crossband function of any radio, because all you're using this for is to decode the signal coming off the air, take it out of the discriminator of the radio, and it sounds like audio buzz, hiss, and this then can interpret it and decode it. In a sense, it makes this a D-Star radio, but just for the purpose of communicating with this. You can't use this to transmit in place of a D-Star radio that you would buy to put in your car, et cetera. Does that make sense?
You only use it because it has a 1200 port.
Well, you want to use a radio that has the 9600 baud port. And I like the 8800. I had one, and it's got the 5-pin mini DIN data connector. And those are pretty standard. And they have both a 1200 and a 9600 baud pin in those. And you can figure. Also, you have a Kenwood TMG707A that I use. It's a single receive dual band, but again, it has that 5-pin mini DIN connector that makes it easy to connect. One more question, then we'll stop for our break.
Okay, something that happens to me, I do have, you know, a few radios, this star, I dangle the VAT. I do have also a Bora Haspar, I got the Satoshi one. I find out really particular when the 96 watts of the 8900 GS on the quad band. You know, if I connect the hotspot to the 2820, it has to be 9600 watts. If I connect to the 710 Kenwood, you know, it has to be 96 watts. This radio does not work in 9600, it works in 1200. You know,
but it's less likely to work just because the 1200 baud it has a lower audio frequency response, and therefore it makes it more difficult to encode and decode the data signal.
Yeah, and I mean, it works, and you know, the reports, there is no difference. And it works, and you know,
have a pretty flat response. If it doesn't work, you're more likely to work at 9600 baud.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so
if you have that.
It happens, you know. I didn't know. After 4 days of putting messages on the board, you know, the DV groups, and everybody told me, no, it has to be 9600, and I was frustrated. And I swapped it by accident. Whoops, works.
Yes, absolutely. Okay, let's take about a 10-minute break. It's 10:02 now, so we'll get started right at about 10 after. And we'll start our next module.